Hi everyone, my name is Mandeep, and in today's video we are going to discuss about a new library, NumPy library, and it is really a very important library in machine learning field. And yes, in last video we discussed about pandas, and in today's video we are going to discuss about NumPy. So I have written here that this NumPy is basically a fundamental package for scientific computing in Python, and it is a Python library that provides a multi-dimensional array object. Before jumping on to the hands-on part of coding, we will discuss about brief idea about, and we'll check the official documentation. So for that purpose, let me quickly check it, and we'll show it to you that this is NumPy documentation, and this is the official one. And when you go over there, you can find this link, latest development documentation. Go over here and you will find everything here. So what is NumPy? NumPy, the absolute beginner's guide, installation. Since we are using our Anaconda environment, and we are doing our demo in Jupyter Notebook, so we do not need to install it explicitly, NumPy library. Otherwise, if anyone is working on an independent environment, then he or she may need to install it. So just like any other library in Python, you need to install like pip install and then library name. So everything you can find here: installation, NumPy, quick start, absolute beginner's guide. So you can go and check here, and everything has been very beautifully described. So before starting on the coding part, I wanted to touch base upon this fact so you guys can explore as per your comfort level. So now let's get started with today's hands-on session. So in today's hands-on session, we will use most frequently used NumPy functions, and I will give you a demo how we can use them and in what scenario we can use particular function. So let's get started with coding part. So we first need to import it, import NumPy as np, and now our NumPy library is imported. Now we can as I told you in previous session as well, for suggestions in Jupyter Notebook, you can start typing and hit the tab button and you will get the suggestions. So np.array is a function in library, whereas in you can define your array as it has been mentioned that. So NumPy library is provides you multi-dimensional array. It could be any dimension: 1 dimension, 2 dimension, 3 dimension, 4, 5, whatever. So very first we can create an array, and it is very similar to the traditional Python list, but this NumPy array is quite fast in terms of accessing from memory. So that's why it has been preferred in machine learning over the traditional Python list. So in this, let's say we create an array. So A is my array, and I'm just going to print it. So my this A is a NP array, which is of 1 dimension. So we can check the shape with this A dot shape. Sorry. So A dot size will give you the number of elements present in that array, and it is a 1 dimensional array. Next function we can discuss is there is one function which is named as ndim, which gives you the dimensions. So for that, let's say I create some another array. I missed a comma in between. Now you can see this is my multi-dimensional array, and when I call it p.endim, it will give me two. So this is a two-dimensional array for me. And if I do b.shape, it will give me 4x3, because there are four rows and three columns. And if I do the b.size, then it will give me number of elements, how many number of elements are there in my this array. So these are the basic functions, shape, size, endim. Now next we can discuss about dtype. Dtype is a function basically used to check the data type. Dtype stands for data type. So it will tell you which type of data your NumPy array is holding. So let's say if I say b.dtype, now it is saying that this is an array of integer 32 data type, right? 32 signifies that since integer is of 4 bytes, so 4 into 8, and that's why it is signifying it here as int 32. Now if there is one method which is named as item size, it will tell the size of each element in the array. As I told you, this since it is an integer array and integer is of 4 byte, so that's why it is showing that that it is of 4 byte. So after that, there is one method which is basically termed as zeros method, which is like np.zeros, and it will create an array. You will pass the dimension inside it, and it will create an array with all the zeros. So if I say, let's say 3x5, so it will create an array of 3 rows and 5 columns with initialized with all the zeros. Sorry, since we have to assign it, so let's say I have assigned C. Okay, so I need to, I made a mistake in the syntax. So this is the syntax. So if you will see 3 rows and 5 columns, and all are started initialized with zero. Similar to this, we have another method ones, which is basically will start your array with all the ones. So 3x5 of shape of the array, and all elements are initialized with one. Then there is one method which is named as a range, which is very similar to range method in the list. So what it will do, so let's say so what this method will do, this method will create an array between the range. So let me show you an example. Let me show you an example of a range. How a range works is np.arange, and it will give me an array from 2 to 7. So it's a kind of sequence. If you will say 1 to 100, so it will give you 1 to 99. The last element is not in the included. This is by default behavior of list and array in Python as well. So next, if Now, next is, let's say if I want to have an array initialized like from between 2 to 7 with a step size of 2. So here what it will do, it will initialize an array from 2 to 7 and with a step size of 2. So that means there will be difference of 2 between each 2 elements. So like this, 2, then 4, then 6. And since 7 is the last element, so that why it has not included it. The similar way, there is another method which is termed as lin space. Lin space generate basically numbers between a given range with linearly spaced. So here it is. This is my starting number 5. This is my end number 10, and I want 9 element which are linearly spaced. So it will generate the number 5, 5.625. So all these are. So this is one more method, lin space, for generating an array with linearly spaced elements. After that, we can discuss about reshape. So how does reshape work? Reshape works, there is a method which is named as reshape. We have initialized our C array earlier into a shape of 3 to 5. Now, if I want to reshape it into 5 to 3, so what it will do, it will reshape my array. That means earlier we were having 3 rows and 5 columns. Now, if I will reshape it, then it will reshape my array into 5 rows and 3 columns. So you can see. All these functions are small functions, but these are very, very handy and important function when we will be working on developing some machine learning model. So it is very much required to do hands-on before going on to these functions. So after that, there is one more function which I want to talk is Revel function. Revel function, what it will do, it will kind of flatten your array. So let's say you have an array of 3 by 5. So it will create a linear array. So now let's say my C was of 5 by 3. Now it has created a linearly array. So basically what it will do, it will kind of convert multi-dimensional array into single dimensional array. So after Revel, we can discuss about, one more thing I would like to discuss here. And now if I type C again, then you will notice that since I have flattened it using Revel function, so it should show me array into this form. But Revel function does not directly work on the actual copy of the array. What it does, it first creates a kind of clone copy in memory and then it manipulates it. So to get the value of Revel, so it is something like you need to do, you need to assign into some another variable. So, and now if you print D, you can see. After this, we can discuss about minimum, some mathematical functions as well. So let's say I want to find the sum of array, sum of elements in my array. So there is a method which is named as C.sum. And if I want to find the minimum, mean is a function. So mean will give me minimum value is this, maximum value is, I want to use B because C was initialized with all the ones. So you can see in B array, the maximum element would be 9. So my B array was initialized here. So you can see in this array, B is the maximum element. Sorry, 9 is the maximum element. So similarly, there are mean, max, sum, and you can also use, there is a method which will tell you the mean of the array. So this is 4.75, and after that, I would like to tell you that there is another method, like let's say b dot sum. Sum will sum all of the element, but now in sum we can pass based on axis as well. So axis is one more parameter, and what it will do. If you want to sum the elements of multidimensional array using columns, so you need to pass axis as zero. And if you want to sum element of array based on row element, then you need to pass axis as one. So let me show you quickly b dot sum, and value of axis is zero. Then you can see. So now it has summed up. Using columns. So you can see that this was my B, 4, 1, 4, 5, then 7, 12, and then 1, 13. So it has printed 13 here. So then 2, 5, 7, 8, 15, and 5, 20, something like this. And if you will pass value like this, if you want to do sum based on rows, then you need to pass it axis as one. So it will sum up the elements based on rows. So now for first row, 1, 2, 3, 3, and 3, 6, and 4, 5, 9, and 6, 15, this way. So this is sum, and it can be done like if you do not pass any parameter inside it, it will sum all of the elements. If you pass axis as 0, it will sum column-wise. If you pass axis as 1, it will sum row-wise. After that, I want to discuss about the another mathematical functions. There are functions like square root, standard deviation, and so if you will do the square root, so what it will do, it will square root each and every element inside that particular array. Now, since C was the array which was initialized with all the ones, so 1 square root is 1. So that's why it is giving you 1. For B, you can see that now it has done the square root of each of the element. And next, moving on to, there is one more method which is named as standard deviation. So standard deviation is np dot std. Now let's say if I want to calculate the standard deviation, this is my standard deviation. And so standard deviation basically, how standard deviation works, standard deviation is basically a number that describes how the spread out of the values are, like how your values are spread out. So, and there is a mathematical formula which is basically works behind this function, and the same has been used in this function as well. And one more thing, a low standard deviation means that most of the numbers are close to the mean value, or you can say average value. And high standard deviation means that your data points are spread out hugely. They are very far from the mean value. So that's what we can depict from standard deviation. And after that, I want to show some another functions like, now let's say we have B, and similarly, let's say I have I have changed some values in this and created one more copy and assigned it to some another array. So now I have two arrays, B and D. So now what I can do, I can simply sum them up, just like summing two numbers. And all these functions are inbuilt into NumPy. So these are very, very handy functions. Otherwise, you can imagine if you have to sum up and you have to sum up metrics of huge size and you have to write logic by your own. So that is going to be a very difficult thing because then you would have to focus on all these things rather than focusing on actual area. So now B plus D, what it did, it simply sums up 1, 1, 2, 6, 6, sorry, not 6, here it is, and this is B, 2 and 6 is 8, 3 and 3 is 6. So this is this this way we can sum two matrices as well. So all these facilities or functions are provided by NumPy. Similarly, we can add, multiply, divide. So I can show you B minus T. So it will simply subtract element of D from B. Similarly, if I say B divide by T, so it will simply divide each element at the respective location. Each element from D will divide each element of B. So this is how it works. And there is one more function, a large function which I want to discuss here is dot product. So there are scenarios. Sometimes we have to do dot products of our NumPy arrays while building the models. So now let's say if I have D of this shape and assume my E is of this shape. And then if I do D dot E, so, okay, now it is working. So, what it will do, dot will replicate that dot product of matrix. So, and one more last thing, guys, please like my videos, please subscribe my channel. And if you want me to create video on some specific topic, please let me know. Otherwise, see you then. Bye.